You have a red light.
It's a red light.
But Roger would deal with that.
There, here we go.
My point was to look. I don't know if we have.
Good evening. Welcome to the Maine 16th meeting of the Scarborough Planning Board. Will we all rise for the pledge, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Before we continue, agenda item number 5, Mike and Linda Johnson request review of a private way extension for Abbey Lane has been tabled at their request. So if anybody is here for that, I would let you know that that has been tabled. Okay. Karen, you want to read the call, please?
Ms. Saunders?
Here.
Mr. Beely?
Here.
Ms. Auglis? Mr. Fellows? Mr. Mazur?
Here.
Mr. McGee?
Here.
And Mr. Wood?
Here.
Okay, thank you. Do we now have approval of the minutes of April 25th?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Any discussion? Oh, yes, thank you. Before we vote on it, Ms. Saunders and Mr. Beely will be voting members tonight, so you have an opportunity to vote on this particular issue.
Thank you.
Having said that, do I hear an approval of the minutes? It is a motion and a second. All in favor?
Can I vote?
Yes, you can vote.
Raise your right hand, Roger.
That's unanimous.
Now we turn.
Okay. Agenda item number 4, which is something we have discussed over the last few meetings and has come up as a consent item. APCO Rental and Storage, Inc. requests a final site plan amendment review for 95 Pleasant Hill Road, Assessors Map R78, Lot 84A and 85. Jay?
Sure. As you just mentioned, Mr. Chair, this item was before the board, and most recently at your last meeting, the board moved this to consent item, as the board was generally comfortable with the direction things were heading. There were still many outstanding questions in terms of sort of the civil issues, the stormwater, related to stormwater and erosion sedimentation controls and those sorts of elements. Those have been reviewed by our peer review outfit, Witter & Kern. And they are generally satisfied. You have a memo from them that has one or two remaining points that are fairly small in nature. And so staff is comfortable, if the board is, given the direction we're given at the last meeting, we prepared a motion with conditions for the board.
Thank you. Is there any discussion from the board? Considering we have dealt with this in fashion. Robin.
I'd just like to point out a couple things in the staff comments and others. One thing that was being asked for by the town was a waiver to not require a geotechnical engineering evaluation. That's a state requirement, so I don't necessarily feel like that's something that the town should act on. So I was just wondering how staff felt about that waiver.
I'll look down to our technical expert down there. That was actually something that came out of Warner and Kern's memo, and so I asked Angela to take a look at that.
Okay.
Yeah, we talked about that they're going to have an amendment to the stormwater permit,
okay.
So it would have to be as part of that, and that was
okay.
A discussion we had as staff that it wouldn't be a waiver for this board,
okay.
But it would be part of the review for the stormwater permit.
And when will the stormwater permit go through, when they do phases 2 and 3?
Right, phase
okay.
2 triggers the threshold.
Okay.
For that, and so they would need to have that in hand before building permit.
Okay. So there's no real concrete plans for phase 2 and 3 yet. It's just phase 1 on the table as part of this consent item.
Nope. So the board will be approving the full build out. The applicant provided a phase plan, which maybe I can pull up here, hopefully. Sorry, I'm trying to find it for you. that depicts, I believe it's about the first 12,000 square feet of the building will be phase one, but the full, the board is being asked to do the approval for the full build-out of all three phases.
And it, sorry. I just point out to you, too, that the stormwater, the pond modifications itself are part of phase one. So those will be happening as part of that initial construction.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess it's a little bit at risk for them to go to DEP afterwards for phase two and three, but that's kind of on the applicant, that if they have to do additional modifications based on DEP's comments.
Yeah, I've seen the structure recently, and it just looks like it needs an awful lot of work. So, I don't know what to do with it. I don't necessarily feel like I know the importance of having a geotechnical evaluation in this instance, and I guess I'm not necessarily. Let me think about it for a minute, I guess.
I was remiss. Is there anybody here from the applicant? I'm sorry. I apologize. Come on up. Do you have any questions, Robin?
Yeah. Steve, when do you plan to do the geotechnical evaluation, I guess?
It'd probably be twofold. As Angela has said, there's the requirement for the stormwater piece when we go back to DEP to get the stormwater permit for phase two and phase three. Pretty certain the applicant's going to do a small geotechnical evaluation for his building piece for his foundation design.
Yep.
And at that point in time, we do that in the building area.
Okay.
My comments back to the staff in Woodard and Kern with respect to what we had for geotech information, the fact that the basin was an existing basin, it's been there for quite a period of time. One of the comments on a geotechnical type thing, which was an easy one to kind of overcome, was the question about rock and ledge and where that was. And we had some boring information from the record drawings from the sewer. The sewer goes right by the pond. So that was pretty comfortable that we knew, okay, the ledge is very deep. We shouldn't have any problem with that. Visual observations that we had made about the makeup of the pond,
mm-hmm.
It's got granular borrow for all of the berm. It's pretty solid.
Mm-hmm.
Been there for quite a period of time. We know we're going to be doing some modifications to it. Agreed that it needs some work and that it's full of vegetation right now.
Mm-hmm.
Hasn't been cleaned out like it should have been for quite a period of time. So I think the owners now have been put on notice, so to speak, because of the new setup with your rules. They have to sign the agreement, your stormwater maintenance agreement,
mm-hmm.
which is maybe a better mechanism that's not been in place for a lot of period of time, and now you got a owner-operator of a pond that's been in existence for a long time, but they didn't have that obligation when they first built it. Now they're signing a contract that's, you know, goes in the registry, it's a recorded document, so their obligations relative to the maintenance of it, that's a good thing. So, you know, that's how we responded back to the staff, that as far as geotechnically, we thought we were in pretty good shape since it's really a built pond already. One of the questions that a geotech might be able to uncover some more information would be location of groundwater. We're going to line the pond. We've said okay. Rather than worrying about the ability, and I'm pretty comfortable that it'll probably hold water anyway, but we'll put a liner in it. And that coupled with the other retrofit pieces for under-drain bench and so forth, feel pretty comfortable then.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to meet it.
So the soil sample observations that you put in here wasn't using any ASTM method. It was just basic visual observations from either
right.
just a shovel in the ground.
Right.
I guess when you have an under-drain bench, too, the other thing a geotechnical observation may tell you, too, is have you done a perk test or anything like that for the infiltration values?
Well, so the under-drain bench, that'll be all a constructed condition.
Okay.
So we're specifying that material
that
you're putting
comes
in.
To make sure that it has the porosity.
That's all new material. That won't be what's in place today.
Okay.
So that'll be a constructed condition, and we
okay.
put in the DEP standards for that material.
And as far as the maintenance appendix B and what was dropped off in my driveway this week, it's pretty thorough, Steve. Like, for example, I really like what you put on the pond overflow frequency. The trash rack on the outlet control structure should be inspected on a weekly basis. Just if you could just work with staff maybe to update these the inspection forms, because they don't, the frequency doesn't always correlate
okay.
to what's in the narrative, kind of a thing. So,
understood.
All right. Other than that, I appreciate you taking the time to answer the questions.
For the record, name, please, because
I'm sorry, Steve Bushy with Stantec, here on behalf of EPCO Rental and Storage.
Steve, I apologize for.
Oh,
that.
No worries.
Anybody else? Hearing none, I will read a draft motion. I move to approve the application of APCO Rental and Storage for a site plan amended with the following conditions. One, the site is to be developed in accordance with the proposed phasing plan. Two, prior to the start of construction of phase two and or three, the applicant shall provide the planning department with a copy of an amended DEP stormwater permit for the site. Three, revise the plan set to address the comments in Wooded and Curran's memo dated May 16, 2016. Four, the bollards around the propane tanks located in the gravel storage area are to be spaced no more than 3 feet on center around the entire tank. Five, the plan is to be revised to add the town standard site plan notes, and that's to be provided to the design engineer under separate cover. Six, prior to the issuance of a building permit, the plan set is to be revised for review and approval by the planning department. Seven, prior to the issuance of a building permit, the traffic impact fees are to be paid. Eight, once the plan set is revised and prior to the issuance of a building permit, a pre-construction meeting is required. The meeting shall include appropriate town staff, the developer, and their contractor and or engineer. Pre-construction meeting is to be coordinated through the planning department. Any discussion? Any questions on your part, Steve?
Certainly not. All the motions here are conditions are perfectly acceptable, and we look forward to working final pieces out and getting underway.
Thank you. All in favor?
Second.
All right, second. Keep me in order. Okay? All in favor? That seems to be unanimous. Thank you.
We thank you, the board.
Next agenda item, Valentine Development, LLC, request subdivision amendment review for Eastern Village, assessors map R73, plot 21A and 21B. Jay, you want to?
Sure. Just as an overview and brief background of the project, the Eastern Village subdivision was originally approved in 2008 under the provisions of the traditional neighborhood development option overlay of our zoning ordinance. This zoning district is intended to enable flexible and creative design in terms of the subdivision layout, space and bulk standards, really through discussion and approval with this board. And so, as noted, this is the proposed 8th amendment to the plan. So project this size has gone through a couple of iterations, and at this time, the applicant is before the board with a couple of things I'll sort of give a brief overview of. One is to adjust the existing phasing plan. Two, to adjust minor adjustment of some lot lines between some of the single family lots. Adjust lot lines between some of the townhouse lots. And then one of the major components that's being requested tonight is to back with the, I believe it was the 6th amended plan, the applicant received approval. As I mentioned before, this district allows for sort of a variety of housing types and space and bulk standards, so the applicant and board work through an approval to allow for what are were commonly referred to with this subdivision anyway as limited single-family homes and cottage structures in a couple of the blocks, the neighborhood blocks. The applicant is now requesting actually to revert those approvals back to the original approval, which stood through from 2008 up to that 2014 amendment. So it's reversed. reverting back to those areas to what was originally approved. Staff looked at these issues. We really don't have any major comments other than really be sure that the plan notes on the subdivision sheets accurately reflect what's shown on the phasing plan. And we think that can be handled pretty easily moving forward if the board has no other issues. So with that, Mr. Chair, I'll turn it back to you.
Thank you. And I'll turn it over to the applicant.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Carrie Anderson, representing Ballantyne Development. I think Jay pretty much summed it up. So what I guess I'd like to do is just go down through kind of staff comments here and take them maybe one by one to address the items. You hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so here is the proposed phasing plan, which did not get reconciled properly. I'm without an engineer right now, or trying to get another engineer on board. So I've had to do a lot of these changes with my with basically a CAD operator, and there was a there was one item that did get missed. So I did not bring a Mylar tonight, and I'm hoping that going through this, I can provide a Mylar as long as everything is satisfactory, given the mistake. But in any event, getting to that in just a moment, this is what we're now proposing as phase four. And we do have phase three, 3A, 3B, and now we're proposing this area as phase four. That is the first item there. The second item that Planner was talking about was the reconciliation not getting done properly. And that's why I don't have the Mylar tonight, is we did not capture that properly. This is the area that's changed, but we do not have 3A, and 3B. So that will need to be corrected. And that was an oversight. I apologize for that. The next item is deals with workforce housing. And we are working right now with the town planner, Dan Bacon, Tom Hall, and Housing Alliance to address that issue. And we'd like to take it up in phase three. So that is still a... That comment there, I guess, by staff is still correct. It is still accurate, given the adjustment of the phase lines, that we would like to do that in phase three. And then going to what was the previous, the sixth amended plan was we had taken this area down here and we had made smaller lots, and the LSF stands for limited square footage of 1,200 square feet or less. We did the same thing in this area up here. The problem that we found is that people are not real crazy about being limited to the 1,200 square feet. We've had a couple people contact us about, you know, well, can we finish the basement, and we've said no, and they knew about it, but they're unhappy about it. But they knew about it going in and didn't think that they'd want the extra square footage. So what we're doing now is just going back to what was originally the approved plan, which is shown like so. So this is what was approved originally back when the project was approved originally in 2007. And what we had done is we had simply taken some of these areas here and put in some smaller lots. We're just now going back to what the market's responding to. The sixth amended plan, I did bring that, even though I did not submit it as a as an item to be submitted, but I did bring it to show what the difference is between what was originally planned, what we amended as a sixth amended plan, and what we're now looking going back to. So this was originally approved, then we came in, had a sixth amendment, changed it to this, and now we're going back. That's all we're doing. And then we have another change over here between lot 10 and 11. The area for the driveway for 10 was really too big. We wanted to narrow it up, and we also wanted to give this lot right here, which we have a house placement on it, some more room. So that's another change. Then we also have this change right here. I was not able to get a townhouse rendering into you, Jay, for administrative approval. Still waiting for that. But these townhouses right here, we're not looking to add any more. All we're looking to do is adjust basically the lot lines. All of these townhouses are in fee simple ownership. So the line is physically a property line, and it runs through the party wall. There's no condominium association. It's fee simple ownership. From what was previously approved, which was right here, basically the lines have been adjusted to now fit what we have for a townhouse design. So those lines were adjusted there to now correspond with that. And then what we did right here with this particular area is we widened out this lot right here, which is single family, going up against single family and neighborhood retail. We're working with somebody on lot one, and we just wanted to give this particular lot right here a little bit more of a kind of a buffer, if you will. So with that, those are the only changes that we are making for the Eighth Amendment. And I guess what I'd like to do, if there's if everybody's okay with it, would be to make the correction that should have been made in the matrix and get that Mylar into planning, and maybe sometime in the next week or two we can try and see if we can get it signed.
Thank you. Yep. Since this is coming before us for the first time, it's open to public discussion. So if there's anybody here who would like to comment on this particular proposal, I ask them to come forward, state their name, address, and keep their comments down to 5 minutes, give or take. Anybody here? Not seeing any. I close it to public comment and open it up to the board. Mike, you want to start?
I don't have much to add. Seems pretty pretty simple. Gary, the limited square footage, was that designator limited to just those lots that you just illustrated for us? Or?
Well, it's an LSF designation, and it's 1,200 square feet or less. Yes, the lots that...
I'm not sure if this is working or not. Yeah, it is.
Yep. It is.
Okay. So again, this is what was approved in 2007, original approval. What we tried to do, everybody says they want to move down. Well, I'm not sure where the number is at, but
it
doesn't seem like 1,200 necessarily. Seems like 1,200 works some days and maybe other days doesn't. So what we did was we took these lots over here and we tried to respond to what we thought was, you know, building a smaller house, something that's 1,200 square feet or less. And we did the same thing up here. And we built these homes. What we found is there's, I guess, the desire to maybe finish off a little bit more area, and they can't do it. The LSF is designated as 1,200 square feet or less. That's been made clear. That is what we got approved through the town. So that's what we built. And given that that is the case, we feel like it's probably best to just go back to what we had rather than what we thought was maybe the market, and just go back to this right here. And if somebody still wants to build a 1,200 square foot home, we can still accommodate it on some of these lots, but they won't be limited to 1,200 square feet. If then they decide they want to finish up a basement or put an addition on or something like that, they won't be having to move, which is the...
Thanks for that. I guess I'm just kind of curious as to, did that LSF designator, was that initiated by yourself or by the town? Or, I mean, what was the real purpose behind it?
Well, the town has within this zone, we have, as Jay mentioned in the initial opening discussion, we have a lot of liberal opportunity here with space in bulk. I mean, we have zero setbacks. We can, you know, we can kind of do a lot of things. And we, with working with the town and the density factors that we have on some of the single families, 1,200 square feet being two-thirds of a unit, 750 square feet or less being a half a unit.
It came down to space in bulk.
It came down to space in bulk, and at the same time trying to respond to what we thought was a market that was there for 1,200 square feet and less.
Seems and to me, though, the same goal would be met if maybe the definition could be tweaked to maybe above grade. I mean, when I heard you say that folks wanted to finish the basement, that certainly doesn't change, in my view, the real intent of space in bulk and how a particular building is going to fit on a lot.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I mean, I don't know. Maybe Jay does, but I don't know with respect to when the town gave us a density factor of going with 1,200 square feet and counting it as two-thirds of a unit, or 750 square feet or less and counting as a half a unit, whether they were looking at it as, you know, one bedroom versus two bedroom versus three or four or five, and what kind of impact it may have on the services in the school system. I don't know. I wasn't privy to those discussions. All I know is we have that ability. So we said, all right, well, 1,200 square feet seems reasonable. I grew up in 800 square feet, family of five. But, you know,
well,
I guess
for what it's worth, I mean, below grade finished space, I don't think reasonable people would believe that that would be occupied by a bedroom or more. Not saying that it's not possible,
yeah,
but it's often not practical for other reasons, you know, egress and et cetera. But
yeah.
Anyway, back to really the real reason you're here. I have no problem with your amendment, certainly, and would vote for approval of it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for your background.
Nick?
I don't really have much to offer. Thank you.
Okay. Roger?
Just a couple of clarifications. You've mentioned in your presentation that you've actually done some building on some of these lots you want to change?
We have, yep. Part of the amendment to amend to this, part of the amendment to amend this area, we also amended this area, and these are built.
Okay.
Two of them are unoccupied, but three of them are occupied. So we have three of them that have been built out of four.
Okay.
And then we went ahead and did this. When we got this approved, we went ahead and did this as well.
But nothing's been built down there.
No, nothing's been built. This is all vacant down here.
Okay. So with your new phasing,
yes,
are you going to be developing according to your new phasing?
Well, you know, with a project this big,
I'm just kind of curious.
Yeah, no, with a project this big, it's actually not
You're building in four now, aren't you?
Well, we're building in 3A,
okay.
3 and 3A, but you know, with a project this big, it's you know, this used to be phase 9, now it's phase 8. We've kind of reduced the phasing as we've kind of changed the phasing over here. But, you know, I don't suspect phase 5, 6, or 7 maybe will change. Maybe 7 might change and get broken up one more time or something. But, you know, this is a block, and then this happens to be a fairly substantial area. But it's also near the end of the project, too. So, you know, it's just a big project, and you find yourself having to, with infrastructure and whatnot, it's just part of the way it goes.
Sure, I understand.
Yeah.
I think it's kind of interesting, because basically you're responding to what you perceive the market to be, the way I take what you're saying.
Well, I believe, actually, for us to show this as phase four is a requirement, as I understand it, and I wasn't aware of that prior to talking with the planner. So I thought we could kind of change the phasing around as we pleased, but it doesn't appear as though that is what's in the ordinance. So you do have to show where you do kind of have to show phasing. So in other words, you couldn't come into phase six and all of a sudden start without changing that to maybe say phase four, because that's where you're going next, I guess, is what I'm saying. And I wasn't aware that that was the case until talking with Jay about it. But anyway, this is the area that we intend to start infrastructure on. It's imminent. The town has a performance guarantee now. So work should be starting out there fairly quickly.
Okay. Just one last question is, in the staff comments, they refer to cottage units.
Yep.
Are those the same thing as the carriage houses?
They are, and that is something that was removed from what was, I did not address that, I apologize, but we did have a carriage house here, because these are big lots. The reality of it is these lots were so big that they could still accommodate a house and a carriage house, so we just went ahead and took carriage houses again and added them to it, but again, I think just to try and go back to what we had originally approved, make it simple, it just seems like that's the best way to go at this point.
Okay. I'm all set.
Thank you, Roger. Robin?
Because of the proximity to the marsh, are you using a third-party inspector?
Oh, yeah.
Good.
Yeah, we've got a couple of them.
Good. And I know I asked you this the last time you were in front of us about low-impact development and green infrastructure. I think that there's a market for that, too, and I would just continue to encourage you to incorporate that as best you can, or when you seek an engineer, that maybe that would be a consideration. So.
Well, unfortunately, it's not something that we'll be able to do in the portion of the project that's now approved, because it's part of the standard for the TND is the type of infrastructure that's in place. But we do have an additional phase. As I mentioned, it used to be phase 9, it's now phase 8. It's unengineered, it's got DEP approval, it's got traffic movement permit approval, but it hasn't been engineered, and we will be coming to the board to discuss it.
Right.
And at that point there, maybe there's an opportunity to tweak things.
Sure. I just wanted to put the bug in your ear one last time.
Yeah, no, I understand, and actually have become more sensitive to that as I've gotten older, but this really, in terms of the density here, 195 units, really kind of, it's really hard to employ those given the tightness.
Yeah,
and
tight real estate.
Yeah, exactly. So, but I understand what you're saying.
Sure, thank you.
Yeah, sure.
I don't have any comments.
Okay, thanks.
Yep.
Okay, I just have a couple of things.
Sure.
Just to refresh. The top of my list is that the affordable housing units.
Yep.
How is that going to fit in based upon what we'd approved previously?
Yeah. Well, we have made nothing less than a gargantuan effort to try and get buyers that will sign up for a program. We were close last summer. We had a young lady who was divorced, two young children, couldn't make it happen. So we're now working with town manager and other planner, Dan Bacon, to see it in phase three, but it may end up being in the multifamily, and the town is on board with that, is looking forward to it.
Okay,
so
do we have to go through changes here based on what we approved before?
So what I heard Mr. Anderson say is that this time he's not proposing to change where the affordable units, the phases the affordable units are in. If that changes moving forward, I think Mr. Anderson understands from this discussion that he would have to come back to this board, and presumably he'll work with the other committees and staff, as he just alluded to prior to coming to this board. But at this time, I think, you know, based on what I'm seeing, it doesn't require any additional consideration by the board.
The only thing I guess I would just make, just for clarity purposes, is when I say phase three, I'm talking 3A, 3B. There still is an opportunity to do it in phase three, but it's looking more and more like it's going to end up being in 3B. But we intend to meet the obligation that we, that I personally advocated for and put on my own shoulders as my own civic responsibility with the past town manager, Ron Owens, previous.
On your behalf, I know it's been difficult to find.
It's been extremely difficult. We've advertised, we mentioned it at every open house. It's just, you know, I don't know what it is. I really don't. I think it's maybe, you know, new construction is extremely expensive, and, you know, they can probably get existing housing, even meeting the definition, but still get more square footage. I don't know. Again, we're completely stumped by it. We've held meetings here in the planning chambers. We've done townwide emails. We've done advertising. We've really put forth, I think, the best effort that we can outside of, you know, waving a banner every Sunday to try and make it happen. And it's just not happening.
Well, I commend your efforts and, you know, encourage you to continue
them. Yeah.
And I understand you can't do the impossible.
But we are, and I think where the discussion has kind of gone from that is that we will be able to get it into the multifamily part of the project. So we're still, you know, we're not committed. We're still committed. It's just it may be in a different form.
Gotcha.
In perpetuity or something like that, so that, you know, the mission is still achieved in some form or fashion.
Gotcha. My other question, just for my own clarification, you're reverting back to single family units because of supply and demand. Is that what I'm to understand?
I would say yes. It's economic. It's market driven, for sure. Yep.
Okay.
And then the other changes, again, were just lot line changes, mm-hmm. and then changes to the individual lot lines between the townhouses to correspond with what the townhouse building that's being planned there will actually be size-wise, rather than something that was kind of, you know, thought about but never had a plan for.
And you said the townhouses are individually owned. There's not going to be an association
or anything. No. Well, there's an assembly for the whole neighborhood, but there's not going to be a condo association for those townhouses. We don't do it that way. We do it essentially like it was done 100 years ago in, say, Portland. You know, your lot line runs right down through the center of your, between the party wall. It's party wall law. It's a state of Maine law. And that, so you do physically own your own lot, and your lot line happens to run right straight through the center of each side of your neighbor. Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
That's all I have. Anybody else? Okay. I have a draft motion, which is the 8th amended plan of Eastern Village. I move to approve the application of Valentine Development LLC for the 8th amended subdivision plan and phasing plan of the Eastern Village subdivision, provided the following conditions are met prior to the board signing the final plan for recording. 1. The table of note 12 on sheet C 5A be revised to coordinate accurately with the approved phasing plan. 2. A complete plan set is to be submitted to the planning board for review and approval. Is there anything else?
Nope.
I don't understand the second condition. Wouldn't that be staff, engineer, town planner, and engineer?
Yes. Yep. To the planning department.
Okay, planning department, not planning board.
To the board. No, to the planning department.
Okay. Okay, that's fine. Yep.
I'll second that.
Okay. I have a second. Any discussion? All in favor? That's unanimous.
Thank you very much.
Okay, the next agenda item. Sean Moody requests a site plan review for 33 Pleasant Hill Road, assessors map U50, lot 30. Jay.
Yep, Mr. Chair. As you just noted, this is for a site plan amendment at 33 Pleasant Hill Road at the existing Moody's Collision Center. The property is in the industrial district, and there's a back portion of the property that is in the shoreland overlay zone. The applicant is proposing to add about a 2,000 square foot addition that'll have a couple of bay doors, which I'm sure he'll describe the utility of those to the board about. Just to bring the board up, a little background, the site was originally approved in 2000 and received minor amendments in 05 and 06. As I said at this time, they are before the board with an addition off the back of the building. And in our review, staff, you should have received planning staff comments as well as comments from our town engineer, Angela Blanchett. In staff comments, we flagged that as part of the original approval, there was a very specific discussion around parking for this particular use. The board used their discretion to sort of understand that, you know, to look outside the strict table within our parking requirements that would require, you know, sort of more industrial required number of spaces, but really understanding that this use might be a little different than those more general uses, really spent time and looked at the condition of, or the note references that there was a review of the existing site in Gorm, and really coming up with the requisite number of spaces, the board approved for 57. And flag that this proposal appears to reduce that down to about 52 spaces. So that might merit some discussion with the board. Also, just note that the addition has two overhead doors that have that sort of have paved area for sort of ready access, and there's a third overhead door in the rear that accesses this question. But again, maybe the use will demonstrate the capacity there. And then I guess the biggest issue that staff sort of had was this an issue around plan coordination. Based on our review, it appears that the site that's developed and proposed is a little different than what's shown on the plans, and that some of the notes haven't been kept up to date through the various amendments or what have you. Again, I think we just look to ensure that we have good plan coordination around that. We'll note that the site is currently subject to a stormwater permit through the DEP, and that this proposal will require an amendment to that permit. And as I just mentioned, sort of the issues around plan coordination and understanding exactly what's happening on the site, given the additional impervious area, Angela Blanchett's memo sort of spells out a little more detail around those issues, and certainly can more qualified than I to speak on those issues. With that, Mr. Chair, I turn it back to you.
Thank you. I'll turn it over to the applicant.
Thank you. My name's Sean Moody, and before you here tonight, we've been on 33 Pleasant Hill Road since 2000, as Jay described. It's about 15 years. It goes by pretty fast, and our business has grown quite a bit over that period of time, actually at all our locations. So we've come up with a kind of a reinvent the wheel. We want to change our business model so we can kind of help, we call it throughput in our industry, just kind of get cars through faster and more efficiently. And adding these two bays is going to give us a dedicated area to basically dismantle the vehicles that are damaged, do an inspection, and do an estimating process we call blueprinting. We'll ensure that we get all the parts that we need before we start working on the vehicle, and thus go through the shop, you know, faster and more efficiently. I think you can relate just doing a little project around the house, right? It takes you sometimes longer to gather everything up you need to do the job as it does to actually do it. So we're in the same boat. Maine is kind of last spoke in the wheel from a procurement standpoint, so we don't have a lot of dealership networks or presence, so parts, you know, for us to get them in Maine, especially heavily, you know, frame components, things like that, usually take 2 to 3 days, you know, to get to Maine. So it's a little bit more difficult being in a rural state for us to operate. So we're going to basically propose putting 2 additional bays for inspection, estimating, disassembly, if you will. And then the door that Jay described, the smaller entry door, is going to be used for a forklift. So that should be able to make that tight turning radius pretty easily. We're not planning on having vehicles in that bay facing Nonsuch River, the smaller bay door. There's another area that doesn't have overhead door access that we're going to use for storage, inside storage. So when we dismantle vehicles, we have what we call parts carts, which basically contain all the vehicle parts that come off, the damaged parts off the particular vehicle, and then we'll store those in that kind of dry storage area until we need them again. So that's our proposal. We are asking to add some additional impervious area. I think it's around 1,000 square feet. And something I'm not sure, Shawnee Frank's on vacation from Sebago this week, and I have to clarify it with Sean, because for those of you that remember, years ago there was a farmhouse and several outbuildings on that property with a driveway and, you know, gravel entry, paving. So I didn't, you know, probably like Angela, I didn't, after it came to my attention that it extended beyond our original site plan with that paving. So I get on there and looked around, and I discovered that just by doing a kind of a not very accurate, just rough guesstimate, it looks like between 8,000 and 9,000 square feet of impervious area we actually removed, and it was after our site had been approved back in 2000. So I don't know how that's going to, you know, enter into it. I'm sure that will be with Sebago Technics and the planning staff and the DEP, but that I think is a good thing. We reduced it by 8,000 to 9,000, but we're proposing to add another 1,000, and I'm not sure the additional parking that Angela's pointed out. It seems to me, I think what we did is people were parking on that radius over time, and then we repaved. We had to completely dig that hole back up and repave it. And I think what happened is we ended up extending that pavement so people wouldn't back into the onto the lawn. It was pretty much wrecked at that point. The good news, I guess, for in terms of aesthetics, is that we've got a really good, everybody's been by, a good mature landscape plan that came to fruition, so you really can't really even see that area is going to be added on to, pretty well hidden from Pleasant Hill Road. So I, you know, any questions any of the board members may have, I have the planning notes and Angela's notes, engineering notes as well. Be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. I have to formally do this, although I already know the answer. This is also open to the public, since it's coming to us for the first time. So if there's anybody from the public who would like to speak on this issue, please come forward. Not seeing anybody, I close it to the public, open it up to the board. Roger, why don't you start?
Okay. I noticed on your plans, talking about that rear door, it appears that the rear door is smaller than the other two doors which you're going to be using to drive the vehicles in.
That's correct, Roger. The two bay doors are facing the direction of north, right?
The paved area.
Yep, the paved area. Thank you. Those would be, I believe those are 8 by 10. I think that's a 10-foot high by, actually it might be 10 by 10. Those are 2 10-by-10 doors, so we could get in up to like a one-ton truck.
Okay, and the back door is small enough, so it really is not feasible for a regular size?
I think it's, it would probably seem feasible to residential, but not for us. You know, it's 8 by 9, I believe.
Yeah. I don't really have anything else.
Okay, Robin?
Yeah.
Hey, Robin, do you mind what's your background anyway? Asking some pretty technical questions. Are you an engineer?
Yes.
Okay, I kind of picked up on that. I'm not, just so I...
That's okay.
Qualifying that.
That's all right. I like the work that you do. I've actually been to your place. I'm a Pleasant Hill resident.
Cool.
And I got hit by another municipality's plow truck, and you guys were like, there, on it, you did a great job, so, good plug for you. I do have some technical questions for you, though.
Okay.
So, real quickly, looking at Angela's comments about the trees, you taking down the trees?
Yes.
Have you considered some replanting?
There's two trees that'll be impacted.
Okay.
And originally, I'll be honest with you, I wasn't, because we planted 100. I'll tell you what happened, just a quick backdrop. The planning board approved Lifestyle Gym. And during construction, obviously construction is not pretty, and had that all dug up when we came in for our approval, and I think the planning board just kind of like, oh my God, you know?
Yep.
I think Michael remembers this. So anyway, I think it went from maybe one to the other. But we happily planted all the trees.
Okay.
The Dewan Associates came in to represent the town to really get it right. So my original thing was those two trees, we get 100 planted, but talk to Jay. Jay's like, Sean, you might not want to. That's a fairly conciliatory.
Okay.
You know, to plant a couple of trees. So we're okay with that. Jay kind of straightened me out on that.
Thank you, Jay. Thank you, Sean. So do you conduct regular outside inspections of your pavement and your, you know, like your wrecked vehicles or vehicles awaiting maintenance outside? Do you conduct regular inspections of the paved area and the like?
We do. Every day. I'm not necessarily that. Well, we'd look for if there's any leakage or anything, obviously.
Yep.
But every day we have a process that somebody goes and does a lot walk, we call it.
Okay.
So identifies, because, you know, over the weekend something can get dropped off. We don't know. We don't want to sit out back. So it's tagged, inventoried, entered into our management system so that we know it's on the site.
Okay.
So we do, every day.
Okay. Sounds good. I'm wondering then if I was a little disappointed to see in your package that you're asking for a waiver request on stormwater and erosion control. And then I didn't see any sort of stormwater and erosion control in here to see, like,
I can see that. It would be kind of alarming.
Yeah.
We obviously will manage the.
Okay.
Yeah, the sediment. There's not going to be a lot, and it'd be easily to contain, bales of hay.
Yep.
We're not going to just let that.
But you see where I'm going?
Oh, absolutely,
like stuff.
If it's not in writing.
Yeah, exactly. And not to mention, too, when the rain falls on the pavement.
That's right.
Whether it's construction or it's vehicle fluids kind of a thing, there's an issue there. I do like, and I'm very familiar with the facility, so it does flow to a nice vegetated buffer out back of your place. That looks great. But I'm wondering, too, if your Vortechnics unit, if you have to do annual inspections of that, and if so, is this a site that they're reporting that's required to be report to the town yet?
It is not. They developed, as I said, it before.
Right.
The date said it was approved was before we had our ordinance. And this type of the small addition they're putting on doesn't necessarily require that they do annual maintenance.
You knew where I was going, Jay.
We don't have that trigger.
Okay.
But to answer your question, Robin,
Tom
Gorman does our inspections, and
totally
we
know Tom.
The paperwork for.
God, you got all the good answers, Sean.
Well, believe me, it's an expense, but you know, we put in only $10,000 to put that thing in there, so
you got to take care of it.
Exactly.
Good, excellent. So you're keeping records then of whenever Tom Gorman comes, whether it's an invoice or whatever. Excellent, love it. Talk to me about wetland impacts. Do you feel like are there any wetland impacts here? Did the staff look at that at all?
Well, based on Sean's review, I think we're allowed up to 21,000 square feet of impervious area within that shoreline. Correct me if I'm wrong, Jay. And currently we're at 13,000, so we're well below the threshold of what the DEP would allow in that shoreline zone overlay district or overlay area.
Damn, you do your homework.
Well, Sean Frank's a good man. I'll put a plug in for Sean.
I'm going to say something. I'm going to go out on a ledge, and I may be going over the edge, but I wish you were our governor. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Robin.
It would be him.
Right? I know.
Angela, do you have anything to add, ask, while you have the opportunity?
I think it's all in my memo. We need a lot of additional information. Really, I mean, I don't.
Do you want to go down through these notes, Angela, or?
I don't know if the board wants to or not. I'm just saying that there is, there's a lot of information that's needed.
I have, for the board's information, a draft motion that would cover Angela and her comments before anything is done. So let me just put that on record. Personally speaking, I think that as a town engineer, you can handle that. I have all the confidence along with Jay, so no, I don't want you to go all the way down on that.
Okay.
Mike?
I'd like to take a look at your draft motion too. How you doing, Sean? Thanks and welcome back. And maybe it's 15 years too late, but I apologize for any different standard that we may have applied back at Lifestyles versus...
Yeah, I think there was some public sentiment about that. I don't know if it was you, I think.
One of my colleagues who's not here tonight will often talk about Lifestyles. We didn't have as robust an ordinance as it relates to design standards and landscaping as back then as we do now. But we did get a stripe on the Lifestyle building. And you folks have done very nice job in developing that property. It does look neat. Mm-hmm. With one small exception, if you don't mind me saying so, and Jay alluded to it. It does seem that the parking, it seems like you could use more. Because as we look at this plan, it appears that oftentimes cars are parked in the unmarked areas. Yeah, here you go, from left to right, and then even coming back around. So I don't know if that's something that you want to think about in the future. It's not going to keep me from approving what you have in front of me tonight, in my opinion. But I think that you're going to have to keep an eye on that as you continue to grow and get busier.
I think those are valid comments, Mike, and I appreciate it. What we're trying to do, in all honesty, is we're really trying to, you know, we when we first came to town, you know, drove around, you know, through the neighborhoods and whatnot, and I felt strongly that green space coming in, and I can't tell you how many times people have tried to buy that field, you know, and it was a lot to bite off back then, but I'm really glad that we kept that. Not to say I might be back, who knows, down the road for something, but I'm glad we got that green. It really looks nice. That's kind of the gateway. There's a lot of nice mm-hmm. developments, obviously, down Pleasant Hill Road, so we keep it mowed up and everything. So what we do is if we get a lot of work, you know, there's been times when it was kind of spilled over onto the lawn, and people have probably seen it. We don't like to do that, and that's not a long-term solution.
Well, maybe if we've done these kinds of things in the past, because I don't think I've ever worked with anybody that's a real big fan of adding pavement when it's
right.
not necessary.
That's right.
But maybe as you put together a plan that is more reflective of the current conditions, I'm hearing that, you know, we need that. Maybe you can demarcate on that plan where parking will occur
overflow. Yeah,
but
that's a good
you don't
idea.
Necessarily have to pave it.
That's a good idea. I would
at least
be in favor of that.
It would be some visual control and an effort to, you know, keep it in an area that everyone agrees is best suited.
In addition to that, on your notes, you'll notice that when you guys originally approved this, the standard was 10 feet by 20 feet.
Yeah.
And if you were to restripe now, it's 9 by 18, which would open
up,
I think, more
right.
parking also.
You're
so I'll take that
right.
into consideration, too.
Good point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's not enough.
Well, one of the goals of the project, I'm sorry I didn't say that to begin with, I wasn't clearer. One of the goals of the project is to get cars through, which should, right, hypothetically, it should reduce the amount of on-site parking. That's really our goal.
Sure, sure.
Because we're not, you know, we don't have 8 or 10 vehicles dismantled waiting for parts. You know, they're into the shop quicker and through. We don't have to start,
right.
which is the case. The other thing that we've done really well is we have a really good comprehensive management system that allows us to what we call load level. So if one shop is at capacity, for example, and somebody's out for 2 or 3 weeks, we'll give them that opportunity to say, hey, do you mind if we repair a vehicle in Gorham and we'll bring it back so you're not inconvenienced, you can still pick it up in Scarborough. Stand behind it. And customers are very
sure.
yeah, they'd like, they say, if we can get the car back quicker, that's great.
Okay.
So
well,
we've got a better
good.
Job at that.
I might suggest as you bring your date, your plan up to date, that you demarcate where parking will go.
That's agreeable to the board. That sounds a great idea.
Will there be any new lighting on the addition that you know of?
No, we're going to take, there's two existing
wall mounts?
Yes, exactly. Yeah, at the top, we're just gonna basically move them to the front of the addition, so it'll be lower than they were before, but they'll be in the same spot in the front of the new addition.
Okay. No additional, there's no new noise or no,
No, smoke, glare,
And as far as,
We're replacing hot top with a roof, so in terms of impervious, other than the additional paving there,
and
shouldn't be impacted.
I don't know where we are tonight, but, I'm hearing you have a draft motion, but, thank you. So, maybe for staff, what Sean had mentioned earlier about the calculation for impervious service, is that something that, you know, we need to consider tonight? Because we don't have any real data yet, do we?
Right, so what we've looked at, and it's already been touched on a little bit, is when we start to look at the aerials, this is really what we're looking at here, but for where it says proposed addition is what the approved layout was, as was already referenced, there's additional paving around this back radius as well as this front radius. Mm-hmm. A couple of issues come up. One, Mr. Moody already referenced it, has to do with the amount of impervious area that's allowed within the shoreline zone. Very confident that the additional impervious area is not going to go over that 20%. That we're very confident of. The thing we don't know is how does the additional impervious area impact that vortex system? How much area was that system designed for? And so what we would anticipate in the motion that we have crafted anticipates is that Mr. Moody would work with his design engineer to provide a report that says, my vortex system is adequate.
Mm-hmm.
Wonderful. This is an easy conversation. My vortex system is capturing all but 200 square feet. Then we'd say, okay, now we need to have a conversation. What are we doing with that area that's not being captured by this vortex system? And again, we're fairly confident that that's something that could be done at the staff level as a condition, if that's the board's comfortable. Angela, do you want to chime in on that? Anything additional to add?
No, like you said, I mean, without the information, it's hard to say.
But you're confident that you know, if we put forth a motion tonight, you're confident that can be worked out as a condition? And
yes.
Yeah.
Okay, again, that's the if. I mean, this was not definite that we were going to do that tonight.
No, I know. I'm just, you know,
so
testing the waters.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and I'm just responding.
Thank you. And one last question, John. Any additional capacity we needed for garbage, refuse, you know, extra parts, broken parts, et cetera, et cetera? You're increasing capacity, I understand, to some degree, are you not? And with that, does that require a bigger area for your dumpster area or the method in which you rid yourself of?
No, we don't anticipate any.
Okay.
The one thing that we did make a provision for in the addition is that extra dry storage area. Because, you know, out in the shop, you get, we call them parts carts, you know, you get welders, you get equipment, it gets cluttery, you know, and you get, so you've got a elbow room there. So being able to keep these parts carts stored out of the work area is gonna be a big benefit. So
okay,
we're happy about that. And I think we've got about approximately 400 square feet just for that.
Okay, excellent. Well, thank you, and thanks for your continued oversight of that area in particular, and the others, of course, are nice looking. I mean, I think maybe 20 years, 30 years ago, folks wouldn't think of an auto body shop as a potentially nice looking facility, but
I kind of got that feeling back in 2000.
Yeah, I think
when we first came before the board.
I think you redefined.
Had to win. You're over.
Yeah,
yeah.
Appreciate it.
No, thank you, Mike. I appreciate your comments.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Nick?
I'm all set. I think you guys are doing a nice job.
Sean, I just got a couple of questions, and a little of this is a rehash. I support what Mike says as far as parking is concerned, because it seems that business is increasing, and therefore I almost like a catch-22 situation, but I agree that there should be a demarcation of future parking wherever possible. And in light of that, as staff noted, are you going to have the appropriate handicap parking spaces?
I'm sorry, Ron. I didn't I didn't respond to that. That was a good point by the planner and the engineer. Yes, we will put one additional provision, one additional handicap spot in the rear of the lot, for sure. Does that meet the requirement, Jay? Do we need three? We got two out front currently.
Yes, if remembering offhand, between 51 and I think it's 90 spaces, you need three ADA spaces. We do have the chart written site plan, but I think three.
Thank you, Ron, for bringing that up. Good point.
Okay, and just to repeat, that small door is just going to be for a...
Yep, for four-truck access. A lot of times, you know, getting technical about our business, but, you know, we'll get a component. We'll say a rear-end assembly or a rear pickup box assembly, and oftentimes, if it's in the winter, that has to set outside. So this is an area we can, with a fork truck, we can bring that right inside, get it undercover, so it doesn't, you know, it's not out in the ice and snow. It's easier to handle.
Okay. And the last thing, and this is for the board, because I want to know where the board sentiment is. The site is subject to a DEP stormwater permit, and usually when we don't have that, we postpone. Mm-hmm. However, this is an amendment, and I'm comfortable with the fact that it's not a new DEP permit, but an amendment that can be handled through the draft motion if the board is okay with that. But I, you know,
make a compelling argument, I would agree.
Are we okay? Okay. Then I have a draft motion.
Mr. Chair, can I, just for a point of clarity, because I've now heard two board members speak to it, and I think there's good merit to it, but sort of demarking additional parking spaces that aren't currently shown on the plan. I want to be sure I understand what the expectation is, because what I sort of initially thought I was hearing was that currently, from time to time, you'll see cars parked along this area, paralleling, dragging my mouse, I hope everyone can see it up there, paralleling Pleasant Hill Road. And then as you come around this radius that actually is widened out, there's additional paved area here. Are those the type of areas that board members are referencing? Are there elsewhere that you're thinking?
Personally, I would like to see a demarcation for overflow parking in addition to what is shown now.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the area parallel to Pleasant Hill Road and around that radius to the right does not show parking,
correct.
And I would prefer that parking not occur there. I think the site plan looks much neater and presents itself much better to the passerby when you don't park there. I'm not saying that if someone's going to pull in there, a customer's going to pull in there, for minutes at a time.
Sure.
But you know, in the context of actually parking vehicles for long periods of time, so I don't think that's a good place to put them. So I would think, like Sean spoke to the opportunity in the field area that they already use, but by demarcating it, it'll give everybody a guidepost, rather, if you will, limit where it might go. And if you see other areas too, you know, I don't know. I mean, I would be open-minded to that. I don't pretend that I'm going to see it again per se, but that's the concept I have in mind anyway.
Yep.
Is that less vague?
I need to understand, when we're parking in the field, are we talking truly about parking in the field and not worried about being paved, any screening, additional planting? Because I don't know how the access is in accordance with what their approved landscaping plan was.
Mm-hmm.
I think there was quite a dense approval for landscaping sort of all along this back portion.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess I don't want to be... In the access, is the access sort of through an existing parking space? I guess there's just a lot of questions. I think, Jay, honestly,
we've been there for 15 years, and
yeah.
There has been, on occasion, I'm sure everybody's ridden by, they've seen cars parked out in the field. We don't like to put them out there or want to put them out there, but we have.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, as long as we're not going to get in trouble, again, it's not a preferred. I think you ride by there most... 90% of the time, they're not cars out there. But wintertime, snow, I mean, there's things that happen that force us to park out there. But I don't know about having a dedicated area. That's probably, to you, maybe opening up another whole round of questions or
Yeah, I think that's exactly what it is. It's opening that, you know, if it happens, you know, for a couple days, I don't know that our code officers have ever showed up and told you not to do it.
No.
Could they? Yes, so I'm not saying that. So I think, you know, Mr. Wood's point sort of gets to codifying that, and I just, again, if that's the direction we're headed, I do think it would be helpful to have more detail around that to understand, because, you know, if Mr. Moody sells the business and someone else comes in and that's on approved plan, they could use it differently than has been historically. So that's, I guess, where I'm, the direction I'm coming at it from.
Well, again, I think the plan would be improved if you demarcated an area for, let's call it overnight parking, overflow overnight parking. I think it would benefit.
Can I ask a clarification question then? Because now that we're going to be talking about the impervious areas on the site, now you're talking about compacted gravel areas where overflow parking is. I mean, that's all going to be considered part of that. Like Jay is saying, so someone else can come in and use that as parking. Or even overnight parking, there's going to be some sort of gravel base there, which is impervious, I guess. So it does open, I guess, more questions for me.
Yeah,
as
we
well.
We wouldn't have any intention. We wouldn't expect the town to approve any type of gravel area or paved area to the left of the vegetation. This really wouldn't be what we would ask.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm just speaking on a matter of just neatening up the site plan. I'm not thinking of paving. I'm not thinking of impervious surface. I'm not thinking of semi-impervious surface. I don't know.
Where would that be then, Mike? I guess I'm confused a little
bit. Well, if I looked at this site plan, others would know it better, but it appears to me that the area that I would pencil in would be the area to the left.
The field?
Yeah.
What is that now?
That would afford Moody's for additional parking in the event that it's required.
What is that right now? Is that just...
It's all lawn mowed.
It's where the geese hang out.
Oh, yeah.
The what?
Know how to get rid of those things.
Go ahead.
I just have a question. Looking at the site, the overview of the site right here, I live in the Pleasant Hill area, so I go by it all the time. And in fact, I have parked myself parallel to Pleasant Hill Road.
Right front.
Because your business is thriving, and you have a lot of cars there. And I've actually also had one of my cars on the side, too. So I'm kind of curious, what was the reasoning behind not having parallel parking, at least along Pleasant Hill Road? Was it primarily aesthetics, or...
I believe it was, Roger, yeah. I think it was back then. I think there was a minimum setback for the building. So the front parking lot, and again, back in 2000, you know, bringing a body shop to Pleasant Hill Road, the board was kind of like, you know, what the heck? So, but anyway, that is something that does occur. It obviously sparked there.
Yeah.
And it's not something that none of our coworkers parked there, and we don't strike it to park there. But
I mean, as somebody who drives by there all the time, I mean, it that does not bother me. I mean, I commend you for the building, the appearance of the building, and also the interior. When you go inside the building, it's very inviting. You know, it's a terrific business. And if we're trying to resolve or solve a parking situation with the pavement, I have no problem with just adding a few more parking spots there, if that makes any sense.
Well, I looking at that without taking out my protractor, I don't think vehicles parked head on into the building and being able to back out. I don't think there's enough clearance. I mean, in real life, you probably will say to me, "Well, we've had
where
this
are you pointing,
so-called
Michael?
Conflict
right here."
No, the parallel
no,
parking.
No, I'm talking about the existing.
Oh, I see.
It
okay.
doesn't appear to me to
right.
be wide enough.
Right.
But I guess at the end of the day, if we wanted to measure that out and make sure that it would accommodate parallel parking, I would not necessarily be opposed to that. All I'm saying is that there's a lot of parking that goes on at that site that doesn't park in a space. That's all.
I think, honestly, this area right here, was getting beat up pretty good over, you know, like a 10-year period. And I think what Angela pointed out on the Google Earth and JAG, I think there's more parking than what's depicted on that original plan. But we'll, you know, we definitely have to identify that and get with Angela and the DEP to figure out the additional impervious area to make sure we're still well within the capacity of the board technics and the stormwater management. But I think that once that's all kind of as-built, whatever, you know, what do they call it, existing conditions, I think there'll be adequate parking. And also, Ron mentioned the 9x18. Yeah, it's not going to get 10 more spaces, but it'll probably get 2 or 3.
If I could ask just a clarifying question, I guess one of the sort of starting points of this conversation is currently the approval and pending any other action of this board is that the site is to maintain 57 parking spaces?
55 were here.
And you say there's 52 now?
55 to 52.
55.
Right here.
Yep. That might have been a miss.
On the notes on number 15, it says parking 57.
Yep. You're right. Yep. That's an editorial. It's 57. That was what was on the original approved plan. So I guess if the board's still comfortable with that number, certainly staff can work with the applicant to be sure that number doesn't get reduced. And I do hear the comment being raised, at least at one end of the table, about the additional parking areas, but I think as Mr. Moody just pointed out, there is more paving out there than is shown on these plans.
So stripe it, if it meets 57, then you know, it seems like everybody's happy. But that said,
mm-hmm.
it seems to me that, and maybe I'm just naive, but it seems to me that we could still demarcate in periods of, you know, rare overflow where that would occur. So it doesn't occur in areas that we all can agree we'd rather not. At one point, I thought we agreed maybe parallel to Route 1 we didn't want. But, you know, if you do the math and it works and you end up demarcating it for parking, then I guess that's fine, too.
Okay.
Nick.
I guess I'm unclear. Do we have a parking problem at the site? I mean, is that a legitimate concern that there's a current parking problem at the site? Because otherwise, I don't know why we're going through an exercise.
I know. Well, I think in some ways, just
a
helping
spot
out maybe
for more cars and restriping his parking lot. And I mean, last I checked, the proposal in front of us was for some bays, and we might need 4 more spots. That's why I'm asking. I'm not being facetious here. I'm just trying to clarify.
We're going to add. I mean, we're getting down to spaces, but we're going to add 2 spaces, right? Obviously, for the, you know, inspection area. So there's 2 vehicles that will be inside. We'll replace a couple of spaces, but they're inside. They're not parking spaces per se. And I really think we're going to have that additional sweep. It's probably, off the top of my head, 6 or 8, roughly, in that area. So I think we're going to be fine. I really do. Better throughput with the addition and getting the, you know, existing conditions plan, getting the striping redone, I think we'll be in good shape.
Okay.
You know, is that going to be, you know, 5 years from now? I don't know, but for the short term.
I'll just make one last comment on it because I'm getting tired of it. I think when you have a site plan that demarcates parking and there's parking occurring routinely outside of those areas, then it defines for me a parking problem. Not that the individual parking has a problem parking, but the site plan is not accommodating either the demand for parking or where people want to park. So, yes, that's why I brought it up. So if we want to park parallel to Route 1, then stripe it. If during further analysis where this site plan is brought up to date and you add enough parking that satisfies that parking that would otherwise occur in the unmarked areas, then I'm satisfied. In addition to that, I don't think it's a bad idea for the owner to have a demarcated area outside of the paved area in those rare instances where additional parking is needed for a very short period of time. But if there's no traction from the board on that, then I'm fine with it also. So But when an individual comes before us for an amended site plan, we have an opportunity to historically look back and see how well we did in 2000, 2005, and 2006, and can we improve upon it? And I think this is one of those times.
And my only concern would be with the overflow parking, that if you're not, the nature of your business is, you know, you repair leaking, crashed up vehicles. So my only concern with overflow parking, Mike, like you're talking about, is if it's not on pavement, if it is in grassed areas, it should be like the rental car companies, or it should be cars that are in good drivable condition. And so anybody going on those unpaved areas, it should be one of those cars. All of the vehicles awaiting maintenance and the like should be on pavement to confine basically any leaking vehicle, any leaking fluids to the pavement, kind of a thing. So that would be
good point. Yep.
And I think that's an excellent point. I think that's an excellent point. Now back to you. Is that clarified? What the sentiment
clear as mud.
The issue is one, not having details. You know, if the board is approving an outdoor parking space, that's what we're approving. So what is short term? What is a drivable vehicle? It's not so, yeah, I'm getting persnickety about it because we're the ones who need to go out there and field the call. So I think we would need additional details. There's provisions in the ordinance that say all parking in commercial areas needs to be on paved parking. So the board would have to then do a waiver request. We'd have to do, are we concerned with stormwater in this area? Because in time, we know that areas that are used, even periodically, become compacted. So I think there are some greater issues here. I understand what Mr. Wood's driving at, and if that's the direction the board goes, the board acts at the behest of staff works at the behest of the board, so we will do what you at your pleasure. But I do think there are some other issues that do need to be looked at that I would have concerns with our department being able to administer moving forward should there be any complaints or issues.
Wait a minute. I'll get to you in a minute, Nick. See, but I, in listening to everybody, I think there's some valid points in both ends of the table. I think Mike's point of saying, wait a minute, we have a plan, and there's a site, and this is what is allocated as parking areas, and that there seems to be an overflow of parking, and if that's going to be the case, then where should this overflow be? I agree with that sentiment. I also agree with Rahman that maybe it should be a certain type of vehicle that can go into the overflow because it's going to be quick in and out as opposed to sitting there for any length of time. I guess where I'm confused is on the diagram, where can we meet both ends? Where would that area be and satisfy your needs also? That's where I'm not getting clear, Mike. Where would that be on that diagram?
I got a question. I'm not familiar with the site. And is there a reason why this site, other than we're adding to impervious surface area and whatnot, is there any reason why that corner couldn't be filled out and restriped for all new parking?
It is pretty well filled out now. You could do additional pavement through that area, presumably. And I guess, you know, if the board, I guess that's my feeling on it, is it, if the board would like to do some areas that aren't currently depicted as parking, and as Mr. McGee just pointed out, the areas around that radius are areas that we identified through the aerial photography that are already paved and being used as parking. So if there's additional areas with additional concerns, I think that would be something that would be, should come back to the board. I don't know that at a staff level we'd be comfortable sort of with a vague concept of parking in the field where, you know, the board typically gets into issues of buffering and access and lighting and those sorts of things without really having it identified on the lot. If the board is comfortable with waiving those type of standards, then that's fine. But I don't know that there's enough information for staff to be able to do that at this time.
Jay, I'm happy as the applicant, I guess. I'm happy by the request for the addition, I think, to maintain what we originally were approved for. Was it 57?
57.
Is that what you determined, 57? So if the board's comfortable, you know, with the staff, obviously, we can get to 57 or greater with that, in that footprint right there, you know, not the field, but just in that footprint, would be satisfied with that.
Let me go back to you, Jay. Mm-hmm. Let's say we set, as we've had further, that there should be no more than 57 vehicles, and that if that's going to be exceeded, then at that time the applicant has to come back with a set plan as to how many more additional spaces he needs and where.
I guess the one thing I'm hearing from Mr. Woodbush, I think, you know, it's certainly a valid point. Currently, this is occurring, apparently.
Well,
I haven't seen it. Currently, there's parking happening in the field. What I'm simply suggesting, and as I said before, I don't believe our code office has gone out and issued a violation for that. But it's also something that hasn't yet been reviewed. So if it's something that this board wants to codify, I feel that there are additional details that need to be at least understood, if not the board being given clear direction on the waivers you're willing to grant for that in terms of those things that are already suggested. So I guess...
I personally would be happy with staff reviewing the revised up-to-date plan showing increased parking spaces or more up-to-date accurate what exists today already, that it meets the original intent of the plan was 57. And then just the comment that I'm making is that, you know, there appears to be a lot of parking parallel to Route 1 in the unmarked areas, and I think that an effort should be made to minimize that and find other solutions. I would be happy with that at this point. I mean, we've operated here for 15 years in one condition, maybe in the most recent condition, at least another seven, and doesn't appear that it's caused any harm or concern. Code enforcement has gone out there, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, I think it's our duty just to bring up, you know, what I know is occurring, and how this site plan does not necessarily depict where all the parking is occurring. That's all. Okay. So I hope I didn't waste a lot of people's time.
I think you're trying to help, you know, by but get an engineer, a couple engineers here. I'm getting nervous about impervious.
All right, having heard everybody, and I think the comments were all great. I don't think it was a waste of time. And you know me, I want to get in and hang out of here. But I think the comments were all very appropriate. I do have a draft motion. I move to approve the application of Moody's Collision Center at 33 Pleasant Hill Road for a site plan amended. Prior to the issuance of building permit, the following conditions are to be met. One, the plan set is to be revised to address all the comments contained within the planners and town engineers' memos related to the proposal. The revised plans are to be reviewed and approved by the planning department. Two, a copy of the amended DEP stormwater permit is to be submitted to the planning department. Three, a pre-construction meeting is required. The meeting should include appropriate town staff, the developer, and their contractor and or engineer. Pre-construction meeting is to be coordinated through the planning department. And four, approval from the sanitary district is required. Do I hear a second? Do I hear a second?
Second.
Do I have any comments? All of
just a quick question. Do you feel comfortable?
Yeah. Okay. I asked them. All in favor? That's unanimous.
Thank you very much. And I do appreciate your comments, Mike, about trying to extend that out into the field. I think, you know.
maybe it'll get so big someday it'll just be inevitable.
Well, let's keep it green as long as we can, right?
Sure.
That's our goal.
Sean, thank you. And we appreciate your taking to heart all our input.
That's
also.
Awesome.
Thank you.
I think if you look back, like to Michael's point, what did it look like? What did we envision it to look like back then? I'm proud of the way it looks today. Mm-hmm. So I think the planning board did a heck of a job back then.
Looks like it was built a year ago.
Yeah.
Could I just ask one? Are you planning to do the same thing with your other properties?
Yeah, that's a great question, Roger. Yeah, we've got one going right now in Bedford, and it's going to be Gorham. It'll be the four left.
We're actually looking for property to sell for, because we rent our facility over there, so we're hoping to add more capacity, which will take care of some of the parking push that we've got over there right now. Kind of level things up.
And if kids would stop texting, you wouldn't be so busy.
Right.
That, we can all agree, is a real problem. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
One funny thing, Sean, is I'm hearing, including myself, I've had my wife's car in there too for, I hit a deer one day, so. You did a great job. Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, town planners report.
Let's see, I don't have anything at this time, but I think the town engineer has comment.
Wait a minute, says town planners report.
Can I pretend to be a planner?
Town engineer.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to point out, that the town received a canopy grant. So we, put in application to put street trees along the Route 1 corridor. And I pointed out to you guys, just because, I know last meeting, we had a conversation with Alberg about street trees. Dan has been out there and trying to figure out where those go. And so every little bit kind of helps along that corridor and filling in those gaps. And so with this initiative, it's just another step forward with that. Our match is actually some additional plantings at the Oak Hill intersection that we're going to be doing on the town dime, I guess. So that's part of our match. And town staff, between Public Works and Community Services, is doing a great job, and they are going to be installing it. So those.
Very good.
Just wanted to point that out.
Is it on the side or down the?
No, it will be at the, we're starting at the 95 intersect with Route 1. There'll be some trees going in there. There's some other gaps along the way, but all the way down to the veterans home in front of them there, we'll be adding some. I'll be coming in the future to do more, hopefully, with the Route 1 islands.
Nice.
And looking at stormwater and trees planting.
Administrative amendment report.
I do not have anything to report.
Correspondence. I don't have any. Anybody have any? Planning board comments. Angela, you want to just say what we did at transportation, just a general, the last meeting? You know, the spur wink.
Yeah, we had some general conversations, too, about initiatives around town, our complete streets, looking at maybe reuse of the footprint of some of our roads, looking at restriping for bike lanes and things like that. We're getting a lot of comments around town about more bike pedestrian uses and how that interacts with some heavy corridors. So we also started our conversation about access management and how that relates to our transportation plan that we have in place and maybe some updates associated with that. I'm trying to think what else.
That's about it. Thank you. Mm-hmm. I did notice that they worked on the lights at Oak Hill.
Yes.
Now, exactly what is the change going to be on that? I don't know myself. I can't remember.
The site work has been done at Oak Hill intersection. Now, the signal work will be pedestrian crossings, so you can get all four around. You'll probably notice the back shades went up
right.
With the fluorescent rectangle around it, so making those signals stand out.
And that's what's going to happen. Somebody press the button, those will light up.
No. So there is another sign going in that when you push the button, it's a blankout sign. So it'll come up. You'll probably have seen them in South Portland and Portland. When you're turning right, sometimes people don't look as people are in the crosswalk because it's, you know, they can go right on red. So when the pedestrian hits that button, they'll be looking, when they look up at the signal, they'll see a light will come on that shows, you know, to be cautious of the pedestrian in the crosswalk. So those will be going up at that intersection as well, which, and as well as the Hannaford intersection, which has been a big problem with pedestrians getting through there.
I do have a comment. I want to thank the board members who did the walk today and the site off of New Road. I know it gave me a fresh perspective, and so I think it was not an easy walk as I expected.
So I appreciate everybody who did join us. Other than that, do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So move.
Second.
All in favor? Thank you.
Chance, Roger.